Being a private investigator means two things. You can be sure you'll run into trouble, and you can never be sure you'll get out of it. Not much you can do about it, I guess, except, like Julie always says,
walk softly, Peter Troy.
And now Peter Troy investigates A Flight of Fancy.
Father? Father?
No statements for the press this morning. Sorry, absolutely no comment. Much too busy.
Father, will you listen to me?
Come back in a month. No, maybe 2 months.
Father, this is not the newspapers. It's me, your daughter.
Daughter? Oh, yes, charming girl. Well, goodbye, Elspeth. Have a good trip. Sea voyage put you in the world of God.
I'm not Elspeth. I'm Rhea. Elspeth went overseas 5 years ago.
Did she? She never told me.
You saw her off on the ship. We all did. Father, who's that young man outside?
Young man? What young man? If he's from the press, I can't...
He's not from the press. He says he's your new assistant.
The cheek of him. Send him packing.
Then you didn't engage him as an assistant in the laboratory?
No, not. No. I already have an assistant. A very good man. Fellow named Charles Barnum.
Well, this man says he's Charles Barnum.
He does? Well, he's an imposter. Get rid of him.
Then you did engage Charles Barnum to be your assistant.
Of course. Oh, yes, yes. Wonderful fellow. Very smart. Very keen on flying machines.
Father, you promised we'd just work together, you and I. You said you wouldn't have anybody else come here to work.
Oh, need another pair of hands. Too much rheumatism in mine. Is it that daughter of mine, Rhea? Yes, after all. She's only a woman, you know.
Oh, good morning, Professor.
Good morning, Charles. Come in. Have you met my daughter, Elspeth? She's off on a trip overseas, you know.
Oh, yes, we met outside, but I thought you said your name is Rhea.
It is.
I say, Charles, a word of warning. There's some fella hanging about the place, giving out that he's you. Probably a spy sent by a foreign power. The German Kaiser's up to his tricks again.
The Kaiser?
And all those Americans, you can't trust that Teddy Roosevelt, you know, unscrupulous demagogue. Better keep an eye out for trouble. We don't want anybody to get on to our secrets, do we? You know, when the first flying machine gets off the ground, she's going to be carrying the Union Jack.
A lot of people seem to think that the life of a private investigator is pretty much taken up with shooting down swarthy villains and making love to beautiful girls. Well, sometimes I wish they were right. But take it from me, the life of a private eye is a little more wearing on the system than that. Swarthy villains are mostly arrested by the police, and the police do not, as a rule, take kindly to characters firing off blasters all over the place, even if they are private detectives and have a very good reason for doing so. And as for making love to beautiful girls, well, if you'd met Julie, my secretary, you'd know the meaning of the expression ball and chain. And not that I mind, really. I guess Julie does keep me out of trouble at that. No, it's just that watch your step expression on her face while I'm interviewing a lovely doll that bugs me.
Miss Lightly is here for her appointment, Pete.
Miss Lightly?
She rang yesterday.
Oh, yeah. Hey, what's she like?
Well, I brought my notebook with me.
Your notebook? What's that got to do? Oh, I get it. Mm-hmm. You're staying for the interview.
I most certainly am.
Oh, she's that good, huh?
Better than that. And I'm telling you, Peter Troy, you'd better watch us.
Julie, just give me a chance to stick my neck out before you clobber me, will you? That bit comes later.
I'll show Miss Lightly in. Will you come in, please, Miss Lightly?
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Troy. I'm Rhea Lightly.
How was that again?
Rhea, as in sunshine, you know?
Rhea Sunshine? Oh, yeah, I get it. Yeah, that's very funny.
I'm glad you think so. Most people groan. It's my mother's fault. She had rather a corny sense of humor.
Oh, she did?
Yes, when I was born, I was so ugly, she took one look at me and laughed for 3 days. Then she insisted on calling me Rhea, since our surname is Lightly. Ray of Light, you know?
Yeah.
Won't you sit down, Miss Lightly? Here.
Oh, thank you.
Well, you may have been ugly when you were born, Miss Lightly, but, oh, brother, there have been some changes made since then.
What? Oh, I see. Well, thank you.
Is something wrong, Miss Summers?
Oh, just something stuck in my throat, Mr. Troy. I find some things a bit hard to swallow, you know?
I know. Well, Miss Lightly, what's your trouble?
It's my father. I'm worried about him. You see, he's an inventor.
And that worries you?
He's rather wealthy, you know, and now he's appointed an assistant, a young man I don't trust.
Oh, you think this character might be trying to get his hands on some of your father's money?
Exactly. My father's so vague about things, a child could rob him blind. I'd like you to check up on this Charles Barnum.
He's the new assistant?
Yes, he's moved in with us. We have a place near Upper Woodlington in Kent. That's where my father works.
Mm-hmm. You say he's an inventor. Exactly what's he working on now?
The flying machine.
You mean a new kind of aeroplane?
Not a new kind of plane, Mr. Troy. The very first plane. My father is busy inventing the flying machine.
There she is, young man. Isn't she a beauty?
Oh, wonderful. What is it?
Pete, play along.
Huh?
Ah, I'm not surprised you don't know what it is, Mr. Agamemnon.
Aga who?
Nobody's ever seen anything like this before. But mark my words, you chaps from the War Department will be very interested in my little invention before long.
We will.
Take my word for it. There's going to be war, you know. Sooner or later, the Kaiser is going to make trouble in Europe.
The Kaiser?
And when he does, this is the machine that will defeat him. Yes, a flying machine.
Wait, you mean that thing's a plane?
A what?
Well, of course it's a flying machine, Pete. You can see that. Well, see, it has wings sticking out the side, just like a bird.
Oh, yeah.
And that thing in front, like the propeller of a ship? Is that what makes it go, Professor?
You are very observant, young lady. Very few people can imagine how my flying machine works. Mr. Achilles, if you will come over here, I can show you some details.
Hey, Julie, what's with this Achilles bit?
But don't you see? He's got you mixed up with the Trojan War. Troy, see?
Oh. Well, who are these characters he's calling me?
Heroes of the Trojan War. Oh, I must admit he's got you a little out of character with the hero idea,
Mr.
But...
Ulysses, come over here, will you?
Oh, Julie, this guy is a nut.
He's a very nice nut. And if he wants to invent the aeroplane half a century too late, that's his business. Now, you go and take a close look at that flying machine. Well, who knows? You might want to fly somewhere yourself someday.
Now, Julie, I quit. And let's have no arguments.
You can't quit now, Pete. You've accepted Miss Lightly's retainer.
Well, give it back. Nobody can retain me as keeper for an old guy who still thinks this is the year 1903 or something.
Well, you weren't hired to worry about the professor. You were hired to check up on Charles Barnum.
Well, what's to check? He's been hired by the professor as his assistant. And if he wants to choose that particular way of going off his rocker, well, I should worry about him.
Well, Miss Lightly thinks he's here to do some harm to her father. And since her mother is dead and her sister's overseas somewhere, well, she's the only one left to look after the old man.
Yeah, well, that could be quite a responsibility.
Pete, what do you think of Charles Barnum?
Think of him? Nothing. Absolutely nothing.
Well, still, you do owe it to Miss Lightly to do some checking.
Well, checking for what?
Well, perhaps he has a police record or something.
That guy with a police record? Oh, Julie, I bet he's never even double-parked his car.
It's odd, though, isn't it?
Now that is the first sensible suggestion you've made all day. It is so odd, Julie, that if we had any brains at all, we will get out of Upper Woodlington and back to London as fast as our little legs can carry us.
Oh, there you are.
Oh, trapped again.
Do you mind if I have a word with you, Mr. Troy?
Yes, but that's not going to stop you, is it?
I'd rather like a private chat with you, if your secretary will excuse it.
Oh, she can't do that. She has to make notes.
Notes?
Anything you may say will be taken down and may be used in the funny papers someday.
Really, Mr. Troy, I don't quite follow you.
Mr. Troy has a slightly warped sense of humor, Mr. Barnum. What he's saying is that I'm always present when he interviews anybody. I'm his confidential secretary.
Oh, I see. It's like that, is it?
No, it is not like that. Now, see...
Oh,
hey,
no offense, Mr. Troy, I assure you. I just wanted to make sure you are Mr. Peter Troy, the private investigator.
Huh?
Mr. Troy is a reporter, Mr. Barnum.
Well, that's what Rhea told me, but of course it isn't true.
Okay, it isn't. You're a smarter crookie than I took you for, Barnum.
I hardly know whether to take that as a compliment or not.
Well, you just run along and give it some thought, huh? Miss Summers and I are leaving.
Leaving? Oh, what a pity.
Pity?
Yes, yes, I was hoping to engage you.
You were hoping to engage me?
Yes. You see, I realize that Rhea got you down here to check on me. She's afraid I might be swindling her father or something like that, I imagine.
Yeah, you catch on quick.
Well, that's ridiculous, of course. Actually, I'm here to protect my own interests.
Mm-hmm. And just what are your interests, Barnum?
I'm an inventor.
Oh, no. No, not another one.
You mean another one like the professor? No, I'm not like that at all. In fact, the professor isn't really like that either.
Like what? The crazy, you mean?
Exactly, Miss Summers. That's only an act he puts on, you know. He's really a very shrewd man. Shrewd enough to be stealing some of my ideas.
Wait a minute, stealing from you?
Yes. Neither he nor Rhea knows who I am, you see. I pretend to be just a laboratory assistant, you know. But I'm convinced that the professor has somehow got hold of some blueprints of mine that disappeared some time ago.
You mean he stole them?
Well, not personally, of course, but he had someone do it. Now, I want those blueprints back. But I don't know where the professor has hidden them.
Oh, brother, inventors, hidden blueprints, this is the wackiest.
Look, I'll pay you well, Mr. Troy. I'll double the fee Rhea promised you. Though, of course, she must know nothing about this.
Oh, yeah, well, I figured that. Well, before I do anything, I've got to take a trip back to London.
Oh? Why?
I forgot to bring my cloak and dagger. In my time, I've handled some pretty wacky assignments. But being engaged as keeper for an old guy who turns out to be nuttier than a peanut bar is somewhat less funny than it sounds and a heap more troublesome than it appears. I practically dragged Julie out of that place by the hair and didn't even bother to say goodbye to Rhea lightly, which at least showed Julie that I wasn't fooling, because Rhea is a very tasty dish and not to be ignored lightly, if you'll pardon my little joke. Back in the nice, sane, normal smoke haze of my office in London, I again went over my reasons for wanting out.
Pete, I can't imagine what all the fuss is about. It was a perfectly straightforward assignment.
Yeah? I get hired to look after that old nut, Professor Lightly, and then his assistant, whom I'm not supposed to trust.
Whom?
Huh?
Whom you're not supposed to trust?
Oh, that's what I said.
And no, you didn't. You said...
Oh, for crying into the sink, Julie, who cares? Look, what did you expect me to do when that creepy assistant, Charles Barnum, ups and offers me double the fee to two-time Rhea Lightly?
Well, I don't know, really.
I am not for sale to the highest bidder, Julie.
Oh, I bet you tell that to all the girls.
Well, in this case, I told it to a guy, remember?
Oh, stop bragging.
Huh? Oh, Julie, look, do me a favor. Draw a check to Rhea Lightly for the retainer she paid me and mail it to her tonight. And that, I think, will end that little matter and we can get back to normal.
I'll do nothing of the sort. It's the silliest idea I've ever heard of. Now, if you think...
Hello, may I come in? There was nobody in the outer office.
Oh, come in, by all means. You timed it perfectly.
I did? I'm glad to hear that. I gather that you're Peter Troy.
That's right. This is my secretary, Miss Summers.
Oh, how do you do?
How do you do?
And my name's Royston. I wonder, could I see you alone, Mr. Troy?
Everybody these days wants to see me alone. Oh, I guess it's my fatal fascination.
No, it's not that.
You disappoint me.
It's just that the matter I have to discuss is rather confidential.
Well, in that case, Miss Summers will have to stay. She always does with confidential discussions. She doesn't enjoy the others nearly so much.
Really, Troy, your flippancy is most disconcerting.
Yes, it is, isn't it? You'll have to pardon me, Mr. Royston, but my last case was even more disconcerting. It's left me, as you might say, all of a tremble.
Ah, that wouldn't be the matter of Professor Lightly, would it?
How did you know that?
Well, it's my business to know about Professor Lightly, a man whom you no doubt took for a complete fool.
Well, that puts it fairly well. A little understated, maybe, but not bad. Well, sit down, Mr. Royston.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, Miss Summers, you better make some notes or something. This should be worth noting at that. Nice to have a funny story to read over on an off day.
Very well, Mr. Troy.
Now, Mr. Royston, let me guess what it is you've come to see me about. Professor Lightly is not a nut, but a brilliant scientist who pretends to be a nut. He is, in fact, working on highly secret government work, which someone or other would dearly love to find out about. How's that for imagination, Julie? Pretty wild, huh?
How did you know that, Troy?
Well, you know, I just made... What? How did I know?
You mean that's all true?
Well, of course it is. Perfectly true. I must congratulate you on finding it out so quickly. After all, you were only on the case for a day.
Yeah, but... Look, are you on the level?
Tell me, Troy, how would you like to make yourself a lot of money?
How much is a lot?
Well, say, £20,000 in cash, in untraceable small denominations.
I would very much like to make £20,000. Who do I have to kill?
Kill? Oh, really? That's rather melodramatic, isn't it?
I don't think so. What you're asking for is obviously pretty crooked, otherwise you wouldn't offer me payment in small bills that can't be traced.
Well, of course, the job is a little, shall we say, out of the ordinary.
Mm-hmm. How far?
There are people, Troy, who will be quite happy to pay the kind of money I've mentioned for the inside story of the secret work Professor Lightley is doing.
And?
And you're already on the inside. You've been engaged by the professor's daughter to keep an eye on some fellow he's engaged as an assistant.
He's one of your guys?
Charles Barnum? Oh, no. No, he's my opposition, as you might say.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Troy, I've already laid my cards on the table. In fact, I've said more than I originally intended without first getting your reaction. What do you say?
I'll tell you what he says, Mr. Rorton.
Royston.
I don't care what your name is. How dare you come here with that kind of proposition?
Button your lip, will you, Julie?
What? Do you realize...
I said knock it off. Okay, Royston. You got yourself a deal. For £20,000. Inspector, I gotta see you.
Now, look here, Troy. What's the idea of bursting in here?
Never mind all that official stuff. This is important.
Confound you, Troy. There are, believe it or not, other things in this world that are just as important as your idiotic cases.
This is not my idiotic case. It's an idiotic case for the police, and right now.
Oh, who's dead?
You will be if you let this guy slip through your fingers.
What guy?
The guy that just offered me £20,000 to steal government secrets from Professor Lightley.
What? You know about the setup at Professor Lightley's place?
I do now. This Royston guy told me.
Royston? Who's he?
I don't know. That may not be his real name. Now, he's a well-spoken, well-dressed guy. He's probably working for some big foreign outfit. They're after the secret of whatever the professor's been working on.
And he offered you £20,000 to get this information?
Yeah.
And why didn't you take it?
What? Oh, look, what is this? Oh, I know you don't regard me as a real live saint, Inspector, but... selling government secrets?
Just asking, Troy. After all, it is a lot of money and very tempting.
Yeah.
May as well come in, I think, Royston.
Hey, what is this?
Hello again, Troy.
Royston!
He's heard everything you've just said. My intercom was switched on, you see?
Oh, but aren't you the clever one, Inspector? Oh, look, will somebody tell me what's going on around here?
I'm sorry for the deception, Troy, but we had to be sure that you could be trusted, even though the inspector gave you a most hearty recommendation.
I appreciate your not letting me down on that, Troy.
Look, who is this guy?
Captain Everett Royston. Secret Service.
We've got it. We've the information.
I can't hear what you're saying. Just a moment.
But I said we've got the info... It's so quiet now.
Yeah, the professor insisted I test this silly motor of his. It'll never work properly, but I've got to pretend to be a dutiful assistant. Well, what is it, Miss Summers? Oh, have you and Mr. Troy...
Yes, he sent me to tell you. He's got the blueprints. Come on.
Oh, I say, this is wonderful. Look, he certainly doesn't waste any time, this Mr. Troy of yours.
In more ways than one. That's why I'm anxious to get back to the office.
The professor's office? But I say this isn't...
No, this is his daughter's office. They're in here.
Oh, step right in, Mr. Barnum. I hope you have your money ready, because I've got what you wanted.
You rotter, Troy. You'll pay for this.
What's this? This is Lightley. A gun aimed at her.
It's necessary, I'm afraid, Mr. Barnum. You see, it's not the professor who's the genius around here, but his darling daughter.
What?
Yeah.
And these papers, I think, are what you wanted.
Oh, you devil, give me those.
Stay where you are, Rhea. I don't want to have to use this gun on a lady.
So that's it. All the time, I thought it was the professor just putting on an act to cover up his great scientific skill.
And all the time, his crazy behavior is just a cover for Rhea, who is one of Britain's top scientists in her field.
Troy, I'm warning you. If you sell our secrets to Barnum...
No, now that I know the situation, Rhea, he won't have to sell me anything.
What?
Now take that gun, Troy.
What the...
Thank you very much. I'm obliged to you for your help, Troy. I must admit that the situation here fooled me completely. I never guessed about Rhea being the one with all the brains.
Now, look, Barnum, I made a deal with you for a fee, a big fat fee.
Sorry, Troy, I'd willingly pay you, but it wouldn't do you any good.
What do you mean by that?
I mean that none of you can be allowed to live after I leave here.
What?
Yeah. You see, these papers contain top British government secrets. Much more important than the lives of three foolish people like yourselves.
I told you, Troy. He's a spy for a foreign power.
Exactly, my dear Rhea. A very well-paid spy. And seeing that you were the first to realize that, it'll be fitting that you die first.
Drop that gun, Barnum.
What?
At once, drop it. That's better. Nice work, Troy. Slightly. Oh, and you, Miss Summers, of course.
Thank you.
Oh, I thought you were never going to show Royston. Another second and he'd have gunned Rhea here.
I'm sorry, but I had to wait until he showed his hand completely. Come along, Barnum, or whatever your name is. We want to have a little chat with you.
So, Troy, you just had to go to the police, I suppose. I'll take my word for it. A fool like you will never get rich.
I guess not, Barnum. But I won't go to jail either. And I will sleep nights.
Oh, can I give you people a lift back to town?
Well, thank you, Mr. Royston, but Mr. Troy and I have a kind of dinner date.
What?
Oh, fine. What about you, Miss Summers? I should be free this evening myself, and perhaps you'd do me the honor of dining with me.
Well, thank you. I'd very much like
hey,
to.
Hey, Julie.
But what's the matter with you, Pete? You can't have it both ways, you know. You're stepping out of line in two directions at once. And that means you'll need to walk softly, Peter Troy.
The only thing I personally solved in this case was how to win back an erring secretary who was so two-faced as to make a date with another guy. Yeah, and I solved it by taking her to a very expensive dinner. Yet, somehow, I can't help feeling I was the patsy in that setup, too. Just as I was in the Secret Service plot to make Barnum show his hand and so safeguard the highly secret work Rhea Lightly was carrying on under cover of her father's happily crazy inventing. His reputation for wacky carrying on was a pretty good mask in case anybody came nosing around. Until Barnum showed up. But I guess it doesn't harm the ego to be used by the British Secret Service and striking a blow for the guys on our side of the fence. Yeah, it's something to remind Julia of when she calls me just a no-good, hard-hearted gumshoe.
This was an Art Transit production written by Krizik Jenkinson and directed by Russ Reiter.
This is the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.